The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. We are gathered this afternoon in God's sight, in the spirit of worship and in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We are gathered to remember Rose Marie Monaco and to give thanks for her precious life among us. We gather here in the protective shelter of God's healing love, where we are free to feel and express our grief, to face our emptiness, and to know that through all of it, God is present and cares for each and every one of us. We gather to commend to God with love the life of Rose. For whether we live or whether we die, we belong to our God and to our Lord, who is Lord both of the dead and of the living. I invite you then to listen to these promises of God. God is near to all who call from their hearts. The desires of those who fear and reverence God are fulfilled. Their cries are heard, they are saved. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. All who believe in me, though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Fear not, I am the first and the last and the living one. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore." I want to welcome all of you to the North Haven Congregational Church on the occasion of the memorial celebration for Rose Monaco, welcoming you who are here in the church and through our live stream service, those who may be watching from afar. I know that your presence is a testimony to Rose's wonderful life and a great comfort to her family. As we begin, I just take a moment and ask that if you have a cell phone or some device with you that makes noise on occasion, you might silence it. And then as we continue, I invite us to read together the 23rd Psalm, which is printed in your order of worship. "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me in my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all of the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." And now I invite you to rise in body or spirit and join in singing our hymn, which is "Be Thou My Vision." It's number 642 in the hymnal, but it's also printed in your order of worship.
Be thou my vision, O joy.
Our scripture passage will be read now by Nathan Bodie, who is Rose's grandson-in-law.
I'm reading 1 Corinthians 15:50 through 58. What I am saying, dear brothers and sisters, is that our physical bodies cannot inherit the kingdom of God. These dying bodies cannot inherit what will last forever. But let me reveal to you a wonderful secret. We will not all die, but we will all be transformed. It will happen in a moment, in the blink of an eye, when the last trumpet is blown. For when the trumpets sound, those who have died will be raised to live forever. And we who are living will all be transformed. For our dying bodies must be transformed into bodies that will never die. Our mortal bodies must be transformed into immortal bodies. Then, when our dying bodies have been transformed into bodies that will never die, the scripture will be fulfilled. Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? For sin is the sting that results in death, and the law gives sin its power. But thank God, he gives us victory over sin and death through our Lord Jesus Christ. So, my dear brothers and sisters, be strong and immovable. Always work enthusiastically for the Lord, for you know that nothing you do for the Lord is ever useless.
Let us pray. Holy God of strength and of peace, you who have created and sustain and take away our fragile lives, you, O God, whose ways are not our ways and whose thoughts are not our thoughts, we come into your presence to worship you and to remember with thanksgiving and love the life of Rose Marie Monaco. Grant that your Holy Spirit may embrace us, heal our wounded hearts. Through our tears and the silence of our emptiness, assure us again that ear has not heard, nor eye seen, nor human imagination envisioned what you have prepared for those who love you. Almighty God, whose will is sovereign and whose mercy is boundless, look upon us in our sorrow and enable us to hear your word. Help us hear so that through patience and the encouragement of the scriptures, we may hold fast to the assurance of your favor and the hope of life eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our risen Savior. Amen. And let us continue together in prayer, offering the words our Lord has given us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now I want to invite Rose's granddaughter, Fox and Phillips, to come and share a reading with us.
I'm going to say a few words before I read the poem. It's a very difficult thing to explain grief and even more to live it, but it's something that we are all familiar with and sort of belongs to all people. It is deep and dark, but rarely is it alone. And despite its pain, there is always beauty. for me, it has taken a lot of loss before I could find that. To experience that loss in grief, we have to have something to lose, something precious or sacred or worth losing, like love, like family, like Rose. Grief is bearing that unimaginable sorrow of losing her, but also the gratitude we have for all the experiences that we have with her. The gratitude of the many memories, joys, and sorrows experienced with her for all of us. I think of grief as holding a space for those memories. I look at all of my moments with her. Her sweetness and penchant for sweets, her patience with two grandchildren trying to sit on her lap at the same time, her wit and good humor, her joy that she found in singing and gardening and all the simple things of life and family. We grieve because we are grateful for what she showed us, and what we get to carry forward into the world in remembrance of her. Carrying it, I carry her with me. I display both my grief and gratitude in the ways I act, in the ways she and others have taught me. I carry forward pieces of imprints she made on me. We all do. Look at this family, at this community, blessed by music, blessed by an endurance of belief and kindness, blessed by hearts open to the differences in the world and the peace of unity that can unite those differences. We carry her in many ways, and she is always with us. The poem I am about to read is a good example of the peace that she has brought as I carry her and the quiet spirit that she brought to all of us with her presence. It is called If You Come Softly by Audre Lorde. If you come softly, as the wind within the trees, you may hear what I hear, see what sorrow sees. If you come as lightly as threading dew, I will take you gladly, nor ask more of you. You may sit beside me, silent as a breath. Only those who stay dead shall remember death. And if you come, I will be silent, nor speak harsh words to you. I will not ask you why now or how or what you do. We shall sit here softly beneath two different ears, and the rich earth between us will drink our tears. Thank you.
I invite everyone to stand and join in singing our hymn, which is In the Garden, and it's in your order of service. Now I want to invite Rosa's grandson, Talon, to come forward to share a reading with us.
I would like to read for you a poem by Francis Thompson. Francis Thompson was an Englishman in the late 1800s who struggled with opium addiction and homelessness before being taken in and writing some of the more powerful Christian imagery. This poem is called In No Strange Land. O world invisible, we view thee. O world intangible, we touch thee. O world unknowable, we know thee. Inapprehensible, we clutch thee. Does the fish soar to find the water, the eagle plunge to find the air, that we ask of the stars in motion, if they have rumor of thee there, but not where the wheeling systems darken, in our benumbed conceiving sores, the drift of pinions would we hearken, beats at our own clay-shuttered doors. The angels keep their ancient places, turn but a stone and start a wing, 'tis ye, 'tis your estranged faces that miss the many splendored thing. But when so sad, thou canst not sadder cry, and upon thy so sore loss shall shine the traffic of Jacob's ladder, pitched twixt heaven and Charing Cross. Yea, in the night, my soul, my daughter, cry, clinging to heaven by the hems, and lo, Christ walking on the water, not of Gennesaret, but Thames. Thank you.
I invite you to listen to a gift of music shared with us by Rose's granddaughter, Chelsea Bodie.
My grandmother in the room that our piano was when we lived in New York, just encouraging me and telling me if I ever wanted to, I could have a whole career in music, and she was just such an encouraging person.
I know where you've been at.
And now I invite Henry Paul Hamus to come forward, Rose's brother.
All right, I'm going to try to keep this under an hour. Now, my sister, when we lost our family, I was 5, she was 15. And she tried to be a mother to me. And through my life, we always kept very close. It was a kind of a bond we had because we had no one else. Boy, I wasn't going to do this, but that's all right. She has, all through her life, she was always there for me. When I needed her, I called on her, she was there for me. The past 3 years, she has, I knew when Bob died, she had to go live with someone. It was either myself or her daughter. When her daughter took her, I said, well, thank you, but she's had 3 years where she just sat with the dogs on her lap and loved her life. And I was so happy for her because she had peace. And I guess that the thing is that it's hard to really, we all have family, but we don't always stay together. And with Rose, we were always very close. And like I say, she tried to be a mother. It wasn't easy for her. She was 15 years old, you know. It's kind of young to be. She already took care of my brothers as it was. And then when we lost them all, she was still there for me. And she never gave up on me. You know. And she's the kind of person that she was very quiet. She was always at peace. And I always felt that a lot of what I got as far as peace in my life, I got from her. Because she didn't anger. She was very quiet. And I've learned that from her, that it's not worth getting angry. So I want to say that I loved her very much. She was the rock in our family. And she was the one that, and she, anyone that knew her, she loved her grandchildren, she loved her children, and she, all through her life, they was the main part of her life. As her children, her grandchildren were, that was, you couldn't say anything. She was part of them all. And she showed me how proud she was of me. And I thank God that she was my sister.
Rose's son-in-law intended to be here to share with us in person, but at the last minute he was not able to make the trip. So I invite you to listen now as he shares his words through the wonders of modern technology. Dwayne Phillips.
Afternoon. First off, on behalf of Brother Lisa and myself and the rest of the family, we would like to thank you for being here today in the remembrance of Rose. The other thing is I want to apologize for not being there in person with you. Every now and then life kind of throws us a curve and we have to kind of deal with that. You know, as I was dealing with some work situations over the last week and a half to 2 weeks, I was musing on how our past and experiences can really tailor who we are and how we respond to situations. And I thought about how well Rose responded in her life and how much I have and should learn from that. Rose was the model for a life well lived. Rose was a sweet and wonderful person. She was so full of joy and love for pretty much everything. You were hard-pressed to find any anger or negativity in Rose's life or her demeanor. And she didn't have a golden or an easy life, but one that she herself had to navigate through. Rose was born in 1936 amid a number of issues stemming from the end of the Great Depression and a country life in the Catskill Mountains. Rose was very athletic and had a love of life, being an avid swimmer. She used to love the bicycle and walking, as well as a joy of outdoors and a joy of gardening that she passed on to her daughter, Lisa, which apparently has skipped a generation, as none of her grandchildren like the garden. At 14 years old, there was a devastating house fire in which Rose lost her two parents, a set of grandparents, and six of nine siblings, enough to crush any teenager's spirit and love of life. Can we imagine what that must have actually looked like? Rose persevered through a blue-collar marriage and an existence where she worked hard at her various jobs while still raising a family and tending to the household. I love my father-in-law, Bob, very much, but he was not always an easy person to live with. Her children and her grandchildren are the jewels of her family efforts. As I've unfortunately in recent years given a number of these kind of talks, I always ask myself, what can we learn from the life of Rose? And not just learn, but what should we be celebrating as a life well lived? Rose loved family and wanted so much the best for others. It didn't matter who you were. She was incredibly loving and incredibly generous. Rose was a strong believer who, in a quiet and unassuming way, was such a strong example for others, much like I imagine Jesus would have handled it, and certainly better than how many of us display what our faith is. Rose loved the finer things in life: furs, jewelry, chocolate, music, and singing, but never obsessed about them and just lived with what she had. Rose had a contentment with what God had provided and finding joy in the everyday daily life. Rose was smarter than what many thought. Her tracking of her husband Bob's workers' comp case over the years was fantastic. And quite frankly, not much ever got past Rose. Rose had a love of music and she loved being in the choir. She has been active in church choirs for way longer than I know and probably longer than I've been alive. She had a love for animals that was inspirational, from years of pet ownership to a love for the dogs that Lisa and I have. Even now, those dogs look at Rose's chair in the living room with longing, remembering her loving ways and the joy of being with her. Did you know that Rose was a card shark? She would sandbag and hold back and quietly kick everyone's butt in the game. No boasting or glory, but just way too many wins. She passed this along to Lisa. I grew up in a family where we used to game, you know, as well. And Lisa and I, it's probably been 25 years since we've actually played gin rummy. She just beats me all the time. It's amazing. Rose loved family. Lisa and I have been married for 40 years, and in that time, Rose made 36 of 40 holidays. Now that sounds really cool, but it's way more awesome because Lisa and I have lived in 27 different addresses, from Maine down to Florida, out to Washington State. Rose traveled and made sure to her best ability that she was there to share important holidays and events with family, always with gifts. I can remember her and Bob arriving, and we would look in the back seat, and the luggage would be sitting on the back seat, and they would open up the trunk, which was just piled high with all kinds of Christmas gifts for her grandkids. Rose was an anchor in the stability due to she was just so calm and steady throughout her life. Others might have been emotional, others might have been chaotic, but Rose was the rock that everyone could anchor to. Rose had a harder life than most of us do, and yet the strength of her face and the sweetness of her soul were an inspiration to all. I only wish that God had provided me with that temperament and sweetness of personality. After all, nobody looks at me and says, there's a sweet person. I know that Rose has tempered not just my life, but the life of so many by an exceptional and beautiful life of quiet inspiration. John Bevere has written a book called Driven by Eternity, and in that book, he tells of a fable to where he tracks the lives of half a dozen individuals and how they walk through their life, all the way up to when they are going to face the judgment seat. And there's this one character in there who is a waitress. She doesn't own anything. She's not a extrovert. She's not out there preaching. But in her own quiet and unassuming way, she just helps others with helping the homeless, with kind words to others. And when she gets to the judgment seat, she's heralded with great honor and great praise. That's how I imagine Rose walking into the throne room August 10th to great accolades and great praise for a life well lived. Rose was a great example of a life lived well and one that we will miss so much. And while we all miss Rose's love for us and love for life, we know that God has another great soprano for his heavenly choir, and we rejoice in that today. Thank you.
I invite you to rise in body or spirit and join in singing our hymn, which is Fairest Lord Jesus. It's number 341 in the hymnal, but it's also in your order of worship. I'm pretty sure everyone who's here can remember Rose in very particular and specific ways this afternoon. As a mother and a mother-in-law, as a Sabrina, please come forward and share your poem. Sabrina is Rose's daughter.
Elvis.
Yes.
Be back here reading this poem is called Look for Me in Rainbows. It doesn't make a difference who it was written by or who it was for, but for 3 years I didn't get a chance to see my mom, and as soon as my sister said you can come, my mother was gone. Can you hear me now? All right. I usually talk very loud, but nobody's hearing me. Anyway, the poem that I chose, because I know we will see each other again, is Look for Me in Rainbows. Time for me to go now. I won't say goodbye. Look for me in rainbows way up in the sky. In morning sunshine, when all the world is new, just look for me and love me as I know I love you. Time for me to go now. I won't say goodbye. Look for me in rainbows high up in the sky. In the evening sunset, when the world is through, just look for me and love me, and I'll be close to you. It won't be forever. The day will come, and then my loving arms will hold you when we meet again. Time for me to part now. We won't say goodbye. Look for me in rainbows shining in the sky. For waking moments and all your high life through, just look for me and love me. And you know I love you too. Just wish me near to you. I miss your mom forever.
Yes, so everyone has particular memories of Rose as a mother, a mother-in-law, a grandmother, as a colleague, a neighbor, a friend, a fellow choir member, perhaps. All of you can close your eyes and think about Rose in very particular moments that you remember. And I want you to recognize and trust that your memories, your affectionate memories, are the most durable monument to her life. So the sharing of those memories and those stories are what continue to weave Rose into your lives and the lives of those around you. I had a great Zoom phone call with Lisa and Chelsea and Foxen and Caitlin remembering Rose. It's a celebration of her life today, giving thanks to God for her 86 years. As you heard, Rose was born on July the 19th, 1936, in Walker Valley, New York. She was the oldest of nine children, born to Evelyn and Harry Polhamis. Rose's brothers, Richard, Louis, who was later known as Louise, Norman, Lawrence, Stanley, and Donald, and her sisters, Teresa and Rita, have died. And Rose is survived by her brother, Henry. Rose's father, Harry, was a lumberjack and a jack of all trades, and her mother, Evelyn, managed and ran the household. Rose learned a lot from both of them. She learned from her mother about caring for the family and watching out for everyone, and she went with her father to lots of exciting places where he was working on his various assignments. Growing up in Walker Valley, they lived in the country. She worked at a resort in Walker Valley as a young teen, and she would ride her bicycle over the mountain roads in order to go to work. Rose loved being the oldest child. She loved taking care of all the younger children, helping them in all the ways that she could, watching out for them. She would come home from school, is my understanding, and peel potatoes every night. There was always things to be done to care for brothers and sisters, and she would get a peanut butter sandwich to sort of boost her energy as she came home from school so that she could move on to the rest of her tasks. And then when she was 14, there was a terrible house fire. And her parents and one set of grandparents and all but three of the children perished. And Rose went to live ultimately with her mother's parents in West Haven. And she got to continue being the mother for her two brothers, caring for them, continuing to watch out for them, and holding on to that sense of family and the importance of shared love. I want you to know some things about Rose. She loved to swim. She wasn't really very fearful around the water, very comfortable. Lisa tells me that she would swim out to the rock way out far from shore and just enjoy it like everything. Rose's grandmother passed away on her 16th birthday. And so Rose baked her own cake and invited her friend Sylvia and some other friends to come over, and she had a party. Anyway, her friend Sylvia was also there when Rose and Sylvia went together one evening to the French Club, and where they were having a dance. And two young guys came in the door, one of whom was Bob Monaco. And Rose looked over to her friend Sylvia and said, "I'm going to marry that one." And then she went over and she asked Bob to dance. Bob said, "I sprained my ankle." So they sat and talked. But it was an auspicious meeting, and they were married and had a wonderful marriage and a wonderful family. I want you to know that Rose Monaco played the French horn in high school. And she was good. And she played it well enough that when Henry bought a trumpet and was having trouble doing the lips exactly right, Rose played that also, showed him exactly how to just so the trumpet would work. Rose worked at Michael's Jewelers and had a lifelong interest in gems and sort of the meaning and symbology of gems and the design of jewelry. She paid a lot of attention, and it helped her to give some wonderful gifts to people. She was a very generous person. When I talked with the family about what are the lessons that they remember, it was to love everybody, to accept people, to be generous and caring, and not to be weighed down by anger carried inside. After a long life of singing and gardening and working and providing for family and neighbors and the kids of the neighborhood, Rose died suddenly and unexpectedly on the 10th of August. I invite you to think about whether there's something that lingers with you that you wish you had said to Rose before she passed away. If that's the case, then I invite you to find a quiet place, or maybe a place where you can listen to the singing as you have a parting conversation with her. I'm confident that she'll be listening. Remember, honor, and cherish her gifts to you. Rose has passed now from life in the body to life in the spirit, from this world to the next. The Bible, which is filled with expressions of thanksgiving, as our guide through life. And so, indeed, we give thanks for Rose's life, her earthly life, now at its closing. We give thanks for all who have loved her and cared for her and welcomed her and sung with her. We give thanks and say goodbye that the healing of hearts may begin. For our great and loving God has received into the everlasting arms Rose Marie Polhamus Monaco, one of his loved ones, as well as one of ours. And now, since you're all almost choir members by now, I invite you to stand and join in singing our final hymn, His Eye is on the Sparrow.
Thank you.
If you'll turn in your order of worship to where the affirmation of faith is, I invite you to read along with me. We believe there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And we know that in everything, God works for good for those who love God, who are called according to God's purpose. We are sure that neither death nor life, nor things to come, nor powers, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. O Lord God, from whom we have received the gift of life breathed into our bodies and into our souls, and to whom we shall all one day return, you who help to soothe and heal the broken heart and embrace us in your everlasting arms, look with tender compassion on your children gathered here, we pray. We have gathered to remember Rose Monaco and to give thanks for her precious life among us. We thank you for her tremendous devotion to her family and to her friends. We thank you for her willingness to work hard. We remember the joy that comes from flowers, particularly when they can be shared with others. We give thanks for the abiding joy of song, remembering that someone has said that the one who sings prays twice. And so we're grateful for the way melodies and lyrics and joy live on in each of us. We remember a life of strength and determination to overcome obstacles and tragedy by relying on faith that seemed unwavering and always adequate to the challenge. We remember singing around the piano. We remember Rose learning to cook Italian food for Bob. We remember the joy with which she guided and supported her children and her grandchildren. And we remember her comfort and joy at being in church and singing in the choir. Most of all, O God, we thank you for her deep and abiding love for her husband, Robert, for her great love for her daughters, Sabrina Selmer and Lisa Phillips and her husband, Dwayne. And we give thanks for her deep love for her grandchildren, Talon Phillips, Foxen Phillips and her partner, Caitlin Hennigan, and Chelsea Bodie and her husband, Nathan. We are so grateful for those who cared for Rose and for the past 3 years when she was welcomed into Lisa's home in order to continue to be near family. Now, O God, Rose is gone, freed from any earthly care or limitation or suffering, and reunited with so many of her family and with Bob. For all the precious private and personal joys that surround her name in the memory of family and friends, we give you our heartfelt thanks. Remember this cherished person, Rose Marie Monaco, we pray, O God, according to the favor which you bear toward all your children. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Rose. Acknowledge, we humbly pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a daughter of your own redeeming, and a daughter of the North Haven Congregational Church. Receive Rose into the blessed rest of everlasting peace and into the company of the saints in light. Holy One, now let your servant depart in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. Her own eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations and the glory of your people, Israel. Amen. Following the close of this service, you are cordially invited to greet the family at a reception downstairs I ask that you just remain here as they leave first, and then you can go down the stairs, which are out the door, and to your left. And just beyond the stairs is an elevator, if you'd prefer to take that. And now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be and abide with all of us who continue in this earthly life, now and always. Amen.